Good afternoon, everyone. Hey, hi, my name is Margaret Downey. Welcome to the Humanism and Humor Funny Ladies Discuss presentation featuring Julia Sweeney and Leighann Lord. And I was so happy to see that their bios were printed in the conference booklet because I want to get started right away and I didn't want to have some long, lengthy introduction. So please note, however, that both Julia and Leighann have written books and they're going to be for sale after the presentation. And Leanne's going to be signing her book, Dick Jokes, Alternative Definitions for Words You've Probably Never Heard Of, But Definitely Will Never Forget. And she'll be signing Real Women Do It Standing Up. Now, Julia is going to be signing her book, God Said Ha. And she's going to be signing her memoir, If It's Not One Thing, It's Your Mother. So since Leighann and Julia are both professional comedians, you know, I thought that maybe I should prepare for this presentation in some way. So 6 months ago, I signed up. I took a comedy course that included how to be a stand-up comic and improvisational preparation. Well, after all that time and all that energy, I only learned one thing.
What was that?
One thing. I'm not funny. So I am just so happy to be here with my funny friends and fellow humanists, Leighann and Julia. Welcome, Julia, Leighann. We are here at the American Humanist Association's 75th anniversary conference, and we have had some terrific speakers on the lineup so far. And I took some notes as everybody was doing their presentation, and I thought it would be fun for you to comment on the different subjects that were highlighted on Friday, and maybe even we'll get to Saturday, but we'll see. Up to this point, anyway. So in his talk, Mark Reimers spoke about MRIs revealing increased brain activity during humanistic actions. So we don't have an MRI machine here today, but I'm wondering what humanist activity would light up your brains?
I think this conference counts. No. When I come to these things, and I don't do it often enough, from the door, I get involved in these absolutely wonderful, intellectual, world-spanning conversations, and I'm like, this is what my life is lacking. And so, yes, my brain is completely lit up when I come here. So if I could, same time next week, you guys, would that be okay?
I want to know, what is a humanistic activity? What are my options?
Well, I think he highlighted volunteer work, thinking about subjects like philosophy and, you know, different things that required some type of intellectual
stimulation.
Stimulation, but mostly it was volunteering.
So no dancing. I thought there was dancing.
So do you
I mean, the volunteering is a complicated issue, I think. Especially, now I'm going to say things that aren't funny. I know, I'm just trying to be funny, I guess. I would say it's definitely for me, I do volunteer work, and I am congratulating myself for doing it so much the whole time I'm doing it that I can barely do the volunteer work. Because I have to spend all my mental time going, you are so incredible that you're doing this. Then I, oh, yes, that's right, I'm doing something for someone. But yeah, I mean, like recently I'm really into, I knew about him, and I knew, you know how you know there's an author, and I know everyone here knows Franz Dewall, who studies the primates and primate behavior. And I've heard him mentioned in a lot of other talks and other talks at humanist conventions, like he's a guy, you know, people talk about. But I never really got into his books, and now I've gone crazy reading. Now I'm just reading one after the other, and I'm sure my brain lights up. I mean, it just makes me so happy to think about us as a social, you know, caring primate who lives in groups and how we interact with each other in the world. It's so fascinating.
She probably lights up.
I'm sure
it
lights up.
Yeah, she probably lights up so bright she doesn't even need a nightlight.
As opposed to when it dims from watching reality television.
Yes. That could dim.
Some reality television, though, is good.
Such
I
as?
Really do think. Project Runway.
Well, yeah, that's pretty good.
No, Project Runway, I know, totally off topic, but to me, I never saw anything that showed what it was like to be, for example, on Saturday Night Live, with that kind of cutthroat competition where you're making alliances and things are going wrong and you think somebody's going to be the winner and they turn out like they aren't, and lots of crying.
And, so it's like Game of Thrones.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I had always wanted to be a fashion designer myself, so I got hooked on Project Runway. And some of the designs that they would come up with are so atrocious, just because they want to be different.
Right. Yeah.
But you'd never want to wear it to a humanist conference, believe me.
Right.
So at the Friday morning session of this conference, Peter Dirks mentioned that life could be extended with the help of organ reunification, and people could actually live up to 5,000 years old.
Okay, where did he get 5,000 from?
Well, I didn't ask him.
Like, why not 1,000? Or why not 10,000?
But would you want to live that long?
I would definitely. What about you?
Really?
No?
No. Well, okay. I think there are a lot of questions that need to be answered. Like, if we live to 5,000, what is the drinking age? What are we changing to?
Ask Noah.
Very good.
Because if we don't get to start till 2000, I'm out. And that's a lot of makeup.
I know. Yeah. I'm sorry.
It just is.
Yeah.
I would, see, I don't have, I would just want to do every career in every, like, I'm thinking I'd want to be a carpenter, then I want to be a doctor, then I want to be an artist, then I want to be everything.
Right, but then again, okay, so then what's retirement age? When does the ageism start? You know, if I want to be a doctor, but then 3,000's the cutoff, because they think I'm too old to do it, you know? I'm not being very positive. I'm sorry.
But think of the horrible college bills you'd have by all of those professions, you know. It's
no,
bad
but I would have so much
right
time.
Now.
I could learn to be a carpenter and I'd have 30 years to make it work.
Right.
And that would just be one thing.
That's true.
You could just Google it. You don't have to pay for anything.
and including printing the degree.
Oh, no, just on screen. Okay. Just click to the JPEG on your phone.
Right.
There you go.
So, you know, we all know about the transgender controversy that's sweeping the nation.
The what?
Transgender controversy.
Have you guys heard of that? What?
And this issue was addressed by Callie Wright on Friday. So I have a question for you, Julia. Which bathroom would your Saturday Night Live character, Pat, use?
Okay, well, that's a much funnier question than I have an answer for, because there really isn't an answer. Because it would all the comedy from Pat comes from people reacting to Pat. So if you were going to do a Pat sketch on the bathrooms, I think it would just have to be Pat nearby two bathrooms, and then people just waiting there long enough to see which one Pat went into. And becoming obsessed about waiting there and not leaving, and then Pat would just never have to go to the bathroom. I don't know. There's no good answer to that for me.
But I'd like to see Pat come back to Saturday Night Live.
Yeah, man. I have the outfit. I'm ready to go.
All right. You know, think of all the rewriting that could be done and put a focus on people like Pat. That, you know, we need more education in that field anyway. So, Bishop McNeil told us about the American Humanist Association's Equality Fund Political Action Committee, which is designed to help secular candidates win government positions. And I'm curious to know, would either one of you ever consider a run for public office, even if you lived 5,000 years?
would absolutely, if I could live longer and didn't have any of my past. If I was able to wipe clean my past, which isn't even that bad. It's just that I feel so sad. Like, there's such a small percentage of people who even can run for public office. I mean, you have to have, like, it's like just feeling like every single thing in your past is going to get drug up and you're going to have to, like, be explaining it and explaining it. But, okay, that said, and I have no plans to run for public office. Of course, I think of it all the time. I wish I could. I wish I could really be there doing something. Yeah. Come on.
Well, see, I think doing something and being a politician are so such completely different things. That unfortunately, I don't know if this makes me selfish. I've never thought of running for public office, unless it's like that Eddie Murphy movie, you know, Boomerang, where you get to run for office just for the benefits of right. healthcare and retirement. That would be great. But I feel like it's almost asking me, do I want to be a Jedi or do I want to be a Sith? You know, do I want to be a regular person or a politician? It's right up there to me with just, you know, being a dentist, you know, like, oh, I'm sorry, I don't mean to insult any dentists. You do good work. People are afraid of them. You know, there's so few good politicians. And like you said, what it takes
and
to
also,
run for office. I didn't
right.
save up enough for that.
And also, they spend like 80% of their time fundraising. Like, I honestly don't think I could do that.
Mm-mm.
And I feel like, look, I don't know if I'd be good person in public office, but I feel like there's so many people who would be good but don't do it because of the conditions under which you have to run in this country.
Right.
I mean,
yeah.
It's you really have to sell your soul. I mean, there's so few people. There's really just so few people who can do it and maintain their sanity the whole time.
Which makes you question the ones who do. It's
right.
Like, what's wrong with you I haven't seen?
Right.
Well, one of your actors on Saturday Night Live is a politician, Al Franken.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any funny Al Franken stories to tell us?
Oh. Well, I might be able to think of one, but the thing that was hardest to watch Al run for office was seeing him have to not be able to be funny for like 4 years. And to see him in so many interviews and knowing him and knowing that he's really the funniest person I've ever met, and also knowing him well enough to know what he was probably thinking while everything was going on, and he clearly decided he wasn't going to be a funny guy. Now it's kind of coming out because he's having a little more confidence, I think, about his staying in that position. But it was like I had to stop watching him on TV because the whole time it was just so painful. Like to have somebody that's that funny not be able to say anything. Oh, God. But anyway, let me see. Well, one thing about Al. See, Al was so funny on the show because he, you know, when you're a writer, especially in comedy, you know this, is like you say, hey, how are you? And it's really how you say it. So that's why certain comedians work with certain writers so much, because the writers understand. They don't have to write, hey, how are you? And then have like a 5-paragraph description on how you deliver that line. You know the actor and how they're going to deliver the line. So one of the great things about being on SNL is there's comedians everybody knows, and so you know how they're going to deliver the line, and there's a lot of shorthand. But then we'd have these guest hosts. We didn't always know. And Al would go to people like Jeremy Irons, like people, you know, like, and go like, Jeremy, it's, hey, what are you doing? Not, what are you doing? Like, and I'd be like, Al, Jeremy Irons, don't tell him how to read the line. But for me, I always liked that about Al. But he was kind of famous for telling actors how to read lines. And you just had to get used to it. And some people just say, fuck off. Like, he would get so mad at him. But I was empathetic with Al because you can't tell. Like, you really, it's such a nuanced thing. Okay, that's not really a story. Let me see. Okay, so I've told this story before, but when Victoria Jackson, who's a born-again fundamentalist, who was on the show, and I was not an atheist when I was on the show, only because I just hadn't thought about it enough to become an atheist by that point. And it was Al, Victoria, and I were sitting around waiting for a set to get set up. And Victoria was saying, well, I don't think we need to, Al said to Victoria, well, if you're a Christian, then you care about taking care of poor people, right? I mean, it seems like Jesus, that was his whole thing in the Bible, was like, we have to take care of poor people. And Victoria said, well, I don't think so, because I just think that when poor people die, I mean, they're just going to go to heaven sooner if they're poor. And so you're really not helping them by having them live longer. And so, and then I literally thought that was a joke. I mean, that's funny, right? I mean, that's like a joke. So I went, Victoria, you really should use that. You should really use that. And she goes, no, I really mean it.
Oh, wow.
And then Al was like, Victoria, you can't possibly mean that. And then he was just like looking at her, and then he just got up and walked away. Anyway, that's one.
Wow.
But you and Victoria corresponded quite a bit after you wrote.
We did for a while. You know, the thing is, I actually like Victoria. And there's lots of good things about Victoria. And one of the best things about her is that she does not hide anything she thinks, because I don't think she can. There's something very reassuring about that.
Yes.
Like on SNL, especially, like, as I said, so cutthroat, so competitive, to have someone like Victoria, like, she would come up and say, I'm really upset with you right now because whatever. Like, and you knew she meant it. There was no double meaning to it. You just took care of that. You can go on. It was actually, there was a lot of good things.
Refreshing.
Yes, refreshing.
Well, Leighann is a co-host on Neil deGrasse Tyson's Star Talk. And yeah, it was a great show. And it just occurred to me that maybe you know something that we hope Neil is going to do, and that's run for president someday.
Oh, man.
Would that be great? Neil deGrasse Tyson.
That would be a smart president.
Yeah.
It feels like Canada. Oh, my gosh. You know, I cannot speak to that or what he wants to do. I know that there are some people that can do the excellent work that they're doing because they're not constrained by public office. And I think he's one of those guys. He's definitely the science rock star, you know, making science and knowledge sexy again. Well, for people that thought it went out of fashion, it did not. But I would vote for him.
Oh, yeah. Do you have any interesting Neil deGrasse Tyson stories for us?
Oh, my gosh. Now I know how it feels. You're on the spot like, oh. Well, you know, the biggest question I get is Neil really like that? You know, I don't know what people think. Like, he has this persona out here, and then, you know, he's burying puppies in his basement. He's not.
He has puppies in his basement?
Well, see, then that's how the rumors get started.
And why are they in the basement?
You know, because cats are dominant.
Oh.
Not true. He is what he presents himself to be. He is absolutely fantastically smart and charismatic and has a deep desire for people to get it. You know, for adults who are not necessarily science literate, you missed something in your educational background, no matter how you come to it, feel free to ask those questions, to learn, to know, to let your knowledge continue to be expanding. He's not an intellectual elitist at all. He's actually very anti elitist in that respect, because he feels the more you hold the knowledge, then the people that don't have it go, well, I don't want it. And then we get into the situation where we're at now in this election year with people sort of fighting facts and reason. So an incredibly great, giving, funny guy. Oh my God, he is hilarious. He gets comedy. Like, he appreciates it as an art form. If you've ever had the opportunity to speak with him or see one of his shows, that's him appreciating the art form of comedy and being able to do it. Great delivery.
Yeah. Well, my friend Abby Haffer, she spoke about animals that shouldn't exist according to the intelligent design theory.
Are we talking about dating now?
No. Not those kind of animals.
Okay, just wanted to show.
Well, she actually put us in our place in the life, the tree of life, and in the universe. And when you think of the insignificance of humanity on that scale, what advice do you have for us all living our one and only life to the fullest?
Oh. And be funny about it?
Yeah, right now I want you to be funny.
You know,
go ahead. No.
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 I feel like it was a hot potato just now and I lost. Honestly, when you realize how short life is, and if you haven't bought into, and you guys haven't, the sweet by and by, it's all here and now, absolutely be less petty, argue less, love more, because we don't have any time. There's no time. There's really, really no time. The clock is ticking whether you hear it or not, and we don't have an expiration date stamped on us anywhere, so you don't know. It's not necessarily the projected, insurance long lifespan. And, if you keep that in mind, there's just no time to be petty and argumentative about things that don't matter. We don't have enough love. We don't have enough laughs. There's not enough dancing.
I would say, when I first became an atheist and adopted a natural worldview, I had so much to learn and so much to think about, and it's so profound. Just the knowledge that that there's no God waiting for us, or there's no heaven, and that we're just. I don't even want to say just. Like, we're this animal that happened to have evolved, and we're going to be here, and we're like a wildflower. Like, we're just here, we're in the sun, and then we're gone. And that was very profound, and it really sustained me for a long time, just the awe of it, just so overwhelming, and so beautiful, like just catching, we're just a sunbeam, But then, as time went on, I realized I didn't really get it from my Catholicism, necessarily a philosophy of life, but it did give a lot of rules to live by, and it gave sort of like what I consider sort of fake, ideas about how to live. But I really realized I was really searching for a philosophy of life. And then I found it in Stoicism. And so I started reading a lot of books about Stoicism, and I think, is Massimo Piliucci, is he here giving something or no?
No, he's not here.
But anyway, I started reading a lot about Stoicism, and there's one book, and all the books have gone out of my head, by Irvine, I think is the guy, Bill Irvine. Anyway, I'm sure a lot of you guys feel the same way, but I really love it. And I really practice it. Like, I do, there's nothing you have to do, but it kind of gives you a way to look at life and some practices, like just about not caring so much about objects, taking time every day to think about death, to think about the fact that you're going to die, like to just, and man, that really can brighten up your day. Like, people think that's a negative thing, but that, I think one of our biggest problems is we don't think about death enough.
Oh my God.
And in fact, I feel like the Christian church, in particular, by having a symbol of a guy dying on a cross, like almost inoculates you, ironically, against thinking about death by having a symbol of death around so much that it does this nothing. And yet, if you really take 5 minutes out every day to really think about death and how your life is so quick and it could be over in the next hour, and you hope it isn't, but even if it's not over for 50 more years, that's really nothing in the scheme of things. It has a really profound effect on your life. I mean, like, it really does. And there's a certain practice in Stoicism where you just keep, there's a name for it that I can't remember, but you're basically just supposed to keep imagining terrible things happening to you and how you'd be okay with those terrible things. So it's like,
oh wow,
it's really like, okay, if I lost my arms, well, I'd have my legs, I would be a runner then, and wow. I would,
doing the first part, not the second part. I imagine the terrible things, and then it's just terrible. I don't get
but then you kind of like make it okay, like, so that, and they even have you think, like, and I think, like, what, like, I'm claustrophobic, so like the worst thing for me to think is that I would be buried alive. Oh, this is hilarious, isn't it? And I do think of it. I think of it all the time. Like, whenever I hear of, like, an earthquake where there's a mudslide, and I think there's people that are buried alive, and there's a certain amount of time they're buried before they die, and they probably aren't going to get found. And then I think, well, what am I going to do? Okay, so one of the things to do, Margaret's like, this is not what we agreed on.
Yeah. One
of the things to do is to take the time out to think of, say, the top 10 times of your life. And not just like, oh, it was fun when I was in college, but like a specific weekend with a specific group of people and a specific movie you went and saw, and you went on the bus, and how did the bus smell, and how did it feel walking into the theater, and what was the movie, or whatever it is for you. And and kind of catalog these wonderful moments so that when you're buried alive, you have a lot of thinking to do. And you can really think about your happy moments.
So instead of panicking.
Yeah, instead of, I know, because my husband's like, what if you could beat yourself out of the mudslide, but you're just sitting there thinking about a movie you saw? I go, it is true. It might not be a very adaptive philosophy.
I don't want to be a stoic.
No, but I don't want to sell stoicism short. It's really great. Okay.
Well, I'm going to read about it now.
I know.
Yeah. Well, shockingly, Elsa Roberts kept using the F word during her presentation. So I want to know, do either of you consider yourself a feminist?
Yes.
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 Absolutely, yes. And I'm I figured now's a good time to be one, because once we make America great again, you might not be legal. Get it in now, everybody.
Because those women should be punished. Something, right. Just punished in some way.
Okay. Yeah. Oh.
Just are we allowed to drink during these? During, or we have to wait till after?
I'm just saying, just thinking of Trump sitting there saying, well, sure, sure. I mean, they've got to be punished when they were talking about the abortion. Oh, my God. Okay.
Well, we heard from John Shelby Spong last night, and he said that he found the current political contest and the Republican frontrunner candidate very embarrassing. And so now I want to ask you, do you want to expand on your commentary about Donald Trump?
Well, I don't find it embarrassing. I mean, Donald Trump is embarrassing. But I don't think the Democratic race is embarrassing. I think it's really fascinating. I'm completely riveted by it. I'm involved. I love Bernie. I love Hillary. I think I would watch news 24 hours a day. I love it. I can't get enough. I find it incredibly fascinating. I don't think we know how that's going to turn out. I mean, I think it's really edge of the seat stuff. And Trump is just such an interest. It's actually a really exciting time to be alive if Trump eventually loses. because he's really, it's like he's, you know, everyone says he's like the id of America, and he is. He's just saying all this crazy stuff. He's really, I mean, people think politics is boring. I mean, and it actually should be boring. That's what makes me so mad. The media, it's not even the media's fault. It's the nature of sensationalism. There's, you know, the most outrageous thing gets the most attention. It's the thing I want to even see. I mean, like, we're all complicit in it. But, I mean, I think one of the things we need to do is make politics boring, actually. It's to make it is policy. It is wonky. You know, like, and I think that it's just interesting to see how all of these, it's like a soup that you put all these ingredients into, which is the American public right now, and Trump is going to come out of it. Like, it's not, I mean, it's just obvious. But I don't think he'll win. I actually don't think he will.
You know, it's funny, I think a Trump presidency would give us the opportunity to practice some of the stoicism you just mentioned. Because I'm having that feeling of being buried alive, like, right now. Yeah, no, it's so fascinating that I actually find myself not watching. And I actually blame the whole political season for now why I'm watching Vampire Diaries on Netflix. It just seems more realistic and manageable. I wish I were lying.
Well, all my caricature artist friends absolutely love the fact that Donald Trump is in the running, because they couldn't ask for a better character to draw and to make fun of.
Well, so, you know, if we get that out of it, it's worth it.
Well, you know, Margaret and I were just at the Humanist Convention in Vancouver, the Canadian Humanist Convention. And
Without me? Really?
Oh, I'm sorry. Next time.
Okay, yeah. And Bill, I think he was the one who said, if Trump wins, the Canadians are going to build a wall, because all the Americans are going to be trying to come up, and you know what? We're going to make the Americans pay for it.
Brilliant. Well, I'll write that check.
I didn't look at homes for sale while I was there. So, you know, Bono testified in front of Congress recently, and he suggested that comedians such as Chris Rock and Amy Schumer be sent to fight ISIS. He did. He actually said that. So I'm wondering if called upon, would either one of you actually volunteer your services?
No. I don't think you want me armed. I don't really think that's a good idea. I have gone over to entertain the troops. I've done several tours there. Thank you. And it was an honor, you know, to do that, because I think we forget sometimes what the cost of war is and what 18 years old looks like. It looks younger than you can imagine. You know, I met guys and it's like, does your mom know you're here? You know, shouldn't you have a curfew? You know, so there's a real cost there. And I felt, you know, that being able to go over and just remind them for a little bit, you know, humor isn't permanent. You know, it's just a temporary, you know, respite, I'm never sure how to pronounce that, from what's going on. And so that humor can do that is important.
But do you think that people in the ISIS movement could laugh at themselves?
Oh gosh, if they could, then they wouldn't be ISIS. Yeah, no.
I agree. Yeah. I agree with what she said.
So you have, you wouldn't poke the
well,
wasp nest.
Well, I mean, I definitely think that humor helps in getting people's attention about and getting them to reflect. I think I take humor very seriously. And I think it does help a lot to have people become more, I mean, for me growing up, just Monty Python, like that was my first window into making fun of the Catholic Church. Like I understood, I was still a Catholic for many years, but I understood, I could see from the life of Brian how that reflected on the church I was in. Like I got it.
Yeah.
And I think that, like, you know, we just need a Monty Python of, you know, the ISIS Muslim world to come up with the same movies, and then everyone's like, ha, ha, ha.
And now you die.
And they're like,
but they never let us air it. They never let us show that.
I know, but that was true here. That used to be true here. And things changed.
True.
Well, that actually gives it more power, because then it becomes bootleg. When you tell people they can't watch something, then they absolutely then want to do that.
Yeah, maybe that's true. Maybe it's different now. Like this true. Underground thing.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I have really had a nice time with this, being the straight person delivering the lines. But we're going to take questions from the audience now, because we did advertise this as an interactive thing. So please step up to the microphone and shoot us some straight lines.
I didn't study. I didn't know.
Thank you. It was a great presentation. Currently, a medical provider can choose not to provide a medical service based on what they call the religious point of view. But more than that, they don't have to tell you about it. They don't have to inform you that such a procedure is available. So what do you think could be done to make people aware of this?
Well, I think there should be a law that says you have to provide, if you're a doctor, you have to provide all services. I mean, I don't understand how somebody, I don't even get how that can be a law. Anyway.
Want an answer?
I don't know how to.
So if you go in and you have a precancerous uterus, and the medical procedure properly is a hysterectomy, and you're one of the 25% of American hospitals that are Catholic, they won't provide a hysterectomy, and they won't even tell you that that's the recommended procedure, even if you've decided you don't want any more children.
Why is that? They don't want to give a hysterectomy because you might not.
Because according to the Catholic,
give birth to somebody?
According to the Catholic ethical directives, which are the principal part of every Catholic hospital, if you lose your uterus, you lose the potential of having another baby.
Well, I don't even think Catholics should have a hospital if they believe in prayer.
I agree that. I agree with that.
Running our hospitals, you know.
Right. Terrible.
I don't know if this addresses your question, but, and I almost hate to say this because it throws it back on the person in need. We almost have to be at all times our own best advocate. And so when you get a diagnosis, you don't see that as written in stone. You see it as an opinion. And I'm learning that more and more now because given all things being equal, be education and income, African Americans receive a substandard level of care. You know, so medical racism is real. And facing that more regularly now, I find that I have to be not only my own best advocate, but for the advocate for people in my family. So going toe-to-toe and going, you are not the last statement on this. And gee, let me consult my attorney is very motivating a lot of times for people.
Yeah, Margaret started by mentioning the Freethought Equality PAC, and I'm on its advisory board, and we would like to have more atheists and humanists to come out of the closet who are politicians. Now, just about all Jewish comedians and Jewish progressives in this country are atheists, so this is for Julia. What do you think is the chance that we can get Al Franken to become openly atheist or humanist?
Well, I don't know what's happening inside his head, but I think he would need to have more. He doesn't want to lose his job. I mean, I think he's making a calculated. If I imagine him to be an atheist, which I actually don't know is the case, I would say he's making
faith.
A calculated risk about it because he really is doing great work.
Yeah.
You know, like, and he really could not be voted in again if that became an issue. And if he said that, they would make it an issue. You know, like, I think if he was in his sixth term or something, you know, when he was so beloved by the Minnesotans, which I absolutely believe will happen, I think he could then. But maybe it's not that important to him. Like, I have no idea what he specifically, but I think it's something that can be sensationalized. And I mean, I know we didn't like the word brights. We tried to do that and it didn't work. And I agree with that, but atheist, it does have a lot of baggage with it. I mean, it is kind of like homosexual versus gay. I mean, it's just a cultural sound of a word. It really doesn't mean anything different. It's just that I feel like the word, like my parents, for example, did not care that I didn't believe in God. It was, and when I said I was an atheist, that they got upset. And it's really true. They really didn't care. I mean, I think they thought, if I spend 30 minutes thinking about it, I probably don't believe in God either.
Well, being an atheist
is different. And if I were in Spokane running for office, and I did think of actually for a second running for office there, I could just imagine what kind of craziness would happen in that town with all the conservative people there saying that I'm an atheist, which would be different than me saying I was a humanist, or if I just wasn't pressed to admit that I was atheist, it would not be. There's something about that word that's so sensationalized, I think.
Well, so, I would be thrilled if Al Franken said he didn't believe in God or said he was a humanist.
Right.
Well,
he does say he's a humanist, doesn't he? I thought he did.
Sure.
Well, I don't know.
But stay there for a second, Herb. If you really like humor and you really like to read something funny, you should read Herb Silverman's book, Candidate Without a Prayer. It's fantastic. It's really fantastic.
Thank you. I'm from Minnesota, and so I'm very proud of Al Franken and our other senator, Amy Klobuchar, which would make a great ticket if they could get it going.
That's true.
But I was in Rochester here last year, and Julia, you were on stage with Richard Dawkins, and it was a great sold-out presentation in Rochester, Minnesota. And at one point, there was a little difference between the two of you.
Yes.
But I'd like to know your impressions of Mr. Dawkins and the new atheism and how that fits with your atheism.
I love Richard Dawkins so much. We had so much fun that weekend. That's like, that would be one of my 10 things that I would think about in the mudslide.
Oh, wow. Is this number 11?
I know. He is so much fun to be with. He's so erudite. He's funny. He's interesting. But we really have a lot of differences. Not substantial differences. We're both atheists, you know. We both think religion can be horrible, you know. But I guess I'm more sympathetic to how religion works culturally. And I have a feeling that maybe the revolution can happen from within, not just without. That's why I've become a Unitarian, and why I'm really a big champion of the Unitarian Church. And I feel, and he's really, like when I said that I was becoming a Unitarian, he was so outraged. He was like, you're going to the other side. I was like,
yeah, I can see
that is so not true. I haven't changed one thing about my philosophy of life. And this wonderful church provides all the other things that I really care about. There's music, there's a community, there's, like, I love it. It's actually, it's just like, why isn't everyone a Unitarian? I mean, like, I don't even get why everybody isn't. So we disagree on that. And also, I feel, and this kind of goes to Herb's comment, in the Jewish tradition, it's become, for whatever reason, really okay to be an atheist Jew and still participate in the rituals, still go to Passover, still, you know, enjoy the rituals of Judaism, and to honor their heritage and those rituals. It seems to be okay, while you also say you're an atheist. I just wish in Catholicism that were true. Like, I don't particularly want to be a Catholic because of so many things I hate about it, but, including I don't agree with anything they say, but, but the, I am culturally Catholic. I can't escape my cultural Catholicism, and I wish there was more people saying, I'm culturally Catholic, but I'm an atheist, but I'm still going to church on Christmas, or I'm still whatever, you know, like participating in it the way I see a lot of my Jewish friends do, because I think that is a path to getting atheism accepted, not just being this outside thing, but a force inside.
So you would go to a Catholic hospital?
No, I wouldn't. I would not. Because, well, first of all, it's outrageous. There's 17% of all hospitals are Catholic hospitals. And they have, this is the thing, don't even get me started on the Catholicism. But it's like, it's 21% of the American public is Catholic, and 30% of the representatives in Congress are Catholic, but they're more conservative Catholics than the Catholics in America. They don't really represent. Yeah. In fact, 50 or 60% of American Catholics believe in abortion is a right and contraception is okay. Actual American Catholics are very liberal. But the people who get in office, and the, 5 of the 8 Supreme Court justices, and it used to be 6 of 9
right
before Scalia, were Catholic. That is a crazy disproportion. And they are conservative Catholics. They don't even really represent regular Catholics. I mean, the typical Catholic, or all Catholics, I should say. And so what upsets me is that there's this huge force of 21% of the public that's Catholic, and half of them or more are really progressives, or at least they're socially progressive. And the people who are in charge, though, who are taking their dollars and their influence in the name Catholicism and pushing through these really draconian, crazy healthcare things with insurance, the Supreme Court, fighting abortion rights. It's, and I don't think the average Catholic really understands how much just being aligned with this church does that, which I know is the opposite of me saying be in the church and say you're an atheist. But anyway.
So I'm really excited to have you here as female comedians and entertainers who are outing themselves as humanists. And I'm wondering, what are some things that we can do to support you in, you know, in your work, but also in your work that's explicitly humanist, and things to sort of present this idea that you could be good and funny without God.
I'm going to be completely self-serving and say follow me on Twitter.
What is your next show? Where are you performing next?
Well, believe it or not, it's in New York City, so this doesn't help you guys, but New York City, I'm at Dangerfield's Comedy Club Tuesday night. So yeah, because humor is important in the dark.
Oh, I don't have anything to say. I don't know how to support me. I don't know how to support myself. Okay.
Well, just very quickly, if social media, I guess, really is the easiest way, you know, whether it's resharing something that, you know, a female comic or a humanist, you know, post that you agree with or like or tickles your fandom, share that, you know, get that word out there. Because I think what disarms people a lot of times is the humor. I mean, I can't tell you how many people have gone, oh my gosh, you're so funny, and you're an atheist? But but you're so nice. You know, which I get what they're saying. You know, I've learned not to sort of judge that. People, you know, do the best they can with what they have. And if the humor is what knocks down the door, then let the door be down. Was that English?
Yeah, no, that was good. I mean, I didn't want to say, I've just gotten off of all social media, so.
Have you really?
Yes.
Like,
I'm done. I'm out, baby. Okay. Gone.
Okay. Voluntarily, or did the judge say? Yes,
no, no. I. It's a little bit of an experiment, but I can't believe how much it has freed up my brain. My brain is I have 50% more of my thinking time back.
Wow. And I'm actually frightened because I haven't touched my phone in 38 minutes. So.
We were more important.
Oh, absolutely. I didn't mean to imply. Just there's craziness going on one side of my head.
In addition to yourselves, are there any female comedians that you'd like to tell us about and encourage us to follow or hear from?
This is why I didn't do as well in school as I should. Whenever I'm asked to come up with names, even though I could be living with the person, as soon as I'm asked, I don't know anyone's name.
I've got an idea.
Yes.
Let's
Diller. Oh, wait, she's dead.
She's dead?
Yes, she is.
Crap. Let's invite Open Victoria. Atheist. Have her come and meet us.
Well, Liz Winstead, big outspoken.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
And Margaret Cho. Kathy Griffin. Kathy Griffin, come on. She's a mainstream comic who talks all the time about being an atheist.
Yeah.
I always feel like my demographic, everyone already agrees with me, so I'm not saying anything. But, like, Kathy Griffin is truly out there with mainstream, working class people who would not normally hear that and just saying it, and she's still incredibly popular. I think that's really great.
Yeah, and we invited her to the Reason Rally, but she had a conflict in her schedule, or else she would have been there.
Oh, yeah, she totally would have.
Yeah. So, you know, we have a lot of female comedians out there. It's just...
Paula Poundstone!
Paula Poundstone, thank you.
Great. Yeah. Who's that?
George Carlin's daughter.
Oh, yeah, Kelly Carlin.
We were in Vancouver with Kelly.
Although she doesn't say she's an atheist.
That's true.
She said she's a humanist, though.
You talked about a smart president. I would say that we do have a smart president, and he's also quite funny.
Yes, I think so, too.
He does a good job at the correspondence
dinner. I think he should host
the
foreign correspondence dinner next year.
Yeah, there you go.
He's
out of office, that would be a good twist, wouldn't it?
My fear in saying that is that, you know, to have that back-to-back, you know, I'm not sure we could handle it. America hasn't reacted very well these last 8 years to having it.
But there was one other thing I heard recently, that the Koch brothers were interested in funding the Antonin Scalia School of Law.
Oh, my God!
But they had to change the name, work out the acronym.
Yeah. ASSA.
As a former elected official, I spent 12 years on the city council. I also wanted to address that issue and encourage people to run locally, because when you run locally, especially if you're not in a big city, you don't have to raise a lot of money. You campaign on a personal level, one-on-one, going door-to-door, talking with people. And there isn't an ideological way to pave the streets and pick up the garbage and so forth. And then also school board, which becomes a little more ideological, but it is still it is the most thankless elected position that exists. Because in most communities, you get paid zero, and you are dealing with people's property taxes and their kids. That's really a thankless job. So
you know you're not selling it now.
I'm a humanist. Although actually the thing is that this is my first conference, but I have been a non-believer all my life, and I've got some gray hairs, so it's a long time. But I spent 35 years in social justice, peace and justice work, working with religious people who were engaged in that, and never had a problem with that. They were dedicated people, committed to the issues, and the discussion of religion was tangential at best. So, anyway.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I have two questions. The first goes back to the second question you raised, Margaret, about, and here it is, how long would most males have to live before 51% of them could really respect women or understand misogyny?
I know, that's true. It might take 5,000 years. Somebody's 4,990. I get it!
The other question is, tell us what's on your bucket list.
Ooh. His name is Carlos, and he comes from... I'm sorry. They're wrong. So wrong. Bucket list.
Well, right now I'm trying to direct a movie. I have a script. It's out. We're trying to get it financed. And I have no idea if it's going to happen, but I really want to try to do that and see if I'm good at it and if I like it. And so that's kind of my number one thing. Bucket list. What are, like, what? Go to Timbuktu or something like that?
Is
that
what a bucket list is? It can be anything. It's your list.
What about you?
I want to be a character on Star Trek. I don't want to be green. I think brown is enough. But I want to be a character on Star Trek.
Is John DeLancey here? Because, you know, he could get you in on... Maybe recommend you.
Please don't tease me. I'm a huge sci-fi in general, Star Trek in particular fan. So yeah, that's a bucket list item if ever there was one. I was very jealous of Whoopi Goldberg when she was Guinan in Next Gen. But you know,
I've hosted Leighann at Dragon Con, which is the world's largest science fiction gathering and it's in Atlantic City.
No, Atlanta.
Atlanta, Georgia. Yes. Atlanta, Georgia.
Very different.
Good grief.
Very different.
Anyway, Leighann was like in this heaven. She was like this. Just she couldn't believe the costumes, and when she got up and did her stand up, she rocked. I mean, it was just golden.
Right.
Because it was her element. It was her thing. You know?
I was geeky before it was popular. I'm like sci-fi big love. Like, I don't get the rivalry between Star Trek and Star Wars. I mean, we all should just agree we had lonely childhoods, and that's why we're in this. But yeah, that was a room full of my people, all dressed in costume.
So, do you use jokes a lot in humor? I mean, humor is different than jokes, right? But do you use jokes in humor? Do you believe in them?
I don't believe!
I feel like that's a trick question. I'm a non-believer. What are you trying to pull here, sir?
What is your conclusion?
I'm not a joke person, but I do like jokes. I like clever dialogue.
So can I tell one?
Oh.
Now we get to the
real... Oh, I should have known that's where this was heading.
Exactly.
It's on his bucket list.
Okay.
Oh, wow.
So our friend Donald Trump, it's December 25th, no, a year from now, he's in the White House, unfortunately. And he gets visited by the ghosts of the president's past. Mr. Washington shows up and he says, "Hey George, you got any advice for me?" And he says, "Beware of tyranny and foreign powers." And he says, "Nah, I don't need any of that. Get out of here." And then Mr. Jefferson shows up and he says, "Thomas, you got any advice for me?" And he says, "Remember, this country is formed by immigrants from all over the whole world." And Trump says, "Nah, get out of here." And then our friend Abe shows up and he says, "Abe, you got any advice for me?" And Abe was such a good humorist. He said, "I don't really have any advice, but I got two tickets to a play."
Any more questions? We have time for one more question, if anybody has
one. Somebody raised their hand. Did you want to go up to the mic?
No, I was just doing the...
Oh, see, yeah, I have to, like, force my fingers to do it. Yeah, I get handicapped parking at the convention because I can't do it right. Live long and prosper.
We're going to go out to the book table. And hopefully you'll get some autographs from Leighann and Julia Sweeney.
Thank you so much.